Yes, hello everyone and welcome once again to the Oval Office. Monopoly at Macca's is in full swing and a man who has swung into the studio like he does each and every week, the Cardiff Grizz medalist. Welcome, Liam Pickering.
Good to be here, Sammy, and looking forward to dissecting last round's games and obviously looking forward too to the finals.
And no glasses today, but I just want you to know you're no less distinguished in my eye.
Well, I'll tell you, I don't feel as smart, but no, I left them at home. Jeez, it was a mistake.
The equation was simple for the Western Bulldogs going into a round 18 with so much uncertainty. Picks. Win, you play finals. Lose, you're going on holiday. And they won it, and the pressure was ferocious.
They were. They were terrific. And, you know, lose, you snooze. Is that right? Or you snooze, you lose.
I think it's snooze, you lose, but yeah. I appreciate what you're trying
anyway,
to do.
Anyway, they didn't do it. They did exactly what they needed to do, and they did it through some sensational stuff in the middle of the ground, I thought. They had a very nice game style. They used the ball better than the Dockers. In the end, well and truly deserved to be in the finals. They're probably the most informed team going into finals.
Yeah.
Outside of the top couple, obviously.
The
ones that in that cluster of teams that were fighting for a spot, the Bulldogs deserved their spot.
And they hunted them, didn't they? Yeah. They won the tackles by 20, the one percenters by 24. They stalked into all corners of the ground there at Canberra.
Oh, they did. And they've got so many... The depth of midfielders in that Bulldogs team is enormous.
It's just about the best midfield going around, isn't it?
Oh, I think it's right up there with the very best. Yeah, I do. Because they've got so much... And they're all different. They've got in and under players like Libba we see there. You've got Bontempelli putting class on. You've got a big body in Dunkley. You've got the pace of Smith. You've got the craft of the likes of Lockie Hunter. McRae, another one that can just rack them up. So I think they've got their depth of their midfield is as good as anybody's.
And just on Libba, he's often forgotten in what is an A-class midfield, isn't it? When you think of, you know, McRae, Bontempelli, Bailey Smith's come on there, Dunkley's in there as well. Libba, though, he is arguably the most important man there, the forgotten dog.
Well, have a look at it. Have a look at his numbers. That was just from last night's game. 25 disposals, 15 contested, 7 clearances. That's a big, big tick. Then you go to the defensive side of the game, and he's had 8 tackles as well and 41 pressure acts. 12 score involvements tells you that Libba is seen as this real hard in-and-under type player, and he is. But I'll tell you what he is. He's a beautiful ball user. Fantastic ball user. We know what his old man was like with the tackle. Mm-hmm. And this guy is just as good in my view because when he has 4+ tackles...
That's extraordinary.
It's unbelievable.
6-1 they are when he has at least 4 tackles.
Yeah, so there you go. So 86% win rate. So if Libba's getting down and dirty, they are going to be very hard to stop because he's got enough class around him. But the thing is, his ball use is so underrated.
He makes good decisions every time.
He makes good decisions. He uses the ball well. He is a very... He was a fine player in that premiership in 16, and I think he might have a big say again this year.
He might be the barometer, but the man in the red, white and blue stationed inside 50 that opposition defenders are petrified of, that is Aaron Norton. Yeah. And he copped a nasty little blow to the face from, it wasn't so little in the end, Sean Darcy, the Fremantle ruckman, old Hodor here, has got him, and he's been diagnosed with a depressed fracture of the cheekbone picks.
Yeah, let's hope it's on the... Some of those... When you get a cheekbone injury, sometimes they can stick a plate in there and they pop it out, stick a plate in, and then they're back in a couple of games or a couple of weeks. So he still might be right for the first final, but they need him because he just gives them that second target with Bruce, someone to kick to, and he's a really hard matchup.
And Bruce did look all right the other night as well, it must be said. But Aaron Norton, as I say, he is the bear in the square there. And he met with the surgeon this afternoon. He'll have an operation tomorrow. And if the fracture isn't too close to the eye socket, my understanding is he'll be back sooner rather than later. But he'll be touch and go for that first final nonetheless. Luke Beveridge, the Western Bulldogs have got there. We think they can do some real damage. And Luke Beveridge, just have a listen to these comments for motivation picks.
And then, as I said, it'll be a different project and we'll be able to play with a different lease of life because as much as we've... Now we've got nothing to lose. You know, before tonight, we had a bit to lose because we feel like we're a reasonable team. Now we've got nothing to lose. We put it all on the line and see what becomes of it.
We've got nothing to lose, he says. Are the Western Bulldogs the most dangerous team that aren't in the top four?
Yeah, I think they are. I think they're West Coast probably that aren't in the top four, but they're right breathing on down their neck, I think, because they've gone in good form. And as he said, nothing to lose. That's exactly the attitude they took in 2016. I know we're going back 4 years, but we know how they played and they got a bit of momentum, they got on a roll. All of a sudden the belief came And their team doesn't look that much different, to be perfectly honest. Mm. To me, it looks like a little bit stronger, if anything, with Norton in the forward line and English playing some good footy in the ruck too. So, look, I think they've got every chance of causing an upset week one.
We've spoken all season long pretty much about how competitive the Sydney Swans are, and they pushed the highly fancied Geelong all the way over the weekend. Pixar took a Paddy Dangerfield fourth quarter masterclass to get the Cats over the line.
Oh, this was a worry. Sitting at home yesterday and I was thinking, this, what could possibly go wrong here? And
did the tacos get piffed at any stage?
No, not quite, but the missus never really spoke to me much during the game. She said she wasn't game, but anyway, they got it done on the back of Danger going forward and thought he was really important. I thought Gary was really important, especially early in the match. Every time he touched the ball, something good came of it, and Danger was just a nightmare matchup for Sydney in the last quarter and a half, really. And his kicking was good yesterday, which was fantastic to see. So they did it the hard way, the Cats, but take nothing away from the Swans' effort. Gee, their effort was good, but that's sort of a chase from Dangerfield sums up the attitude of one of the champs of the game.
Does Paddy Dangerfield need to be inside 50 for them to go all the way? We saw how Richmond a couple of weeks ago really picked them off in the sense that they were probably a little bit too focused on going to Tom Hawkins one out. Dangerfield, you can't afford to do that if you're playing on him. Does he need to be stationed more often closer to goal?
I think... It's probably about a 60-40 mix of Dangerfield mid and forward. That's how I would use him. If you've got Hawkins up and going, and Hawkins' last couple of games haven't been his best, if you've got that, Gary Rowan was hardly sighted yesterday. So if Rowan can do what he does and the little fellas do get to work at the ground level, the likes of now Ablett's back in the side. I mean, the thing about Gary, every time he gets the ball, something happens.
Yeah.
That's the beauty of having Ablett. Now, he might not have the pace and that of some of the other guys, although his pace is still good. And you can have the guys, you know, Myers and these guys are clever players as well. But I think the pinch hit him in there, it'll be a bit of a weapon in the finals.
Let's cast our minds and eyes to Adelaide Oval, where the Hawks, well, they orchestrated the perfect farewell for two of their more celebrated veterans. Ben Stratton playing his last game, Paul Pioppolo the same. It was a goal feast for Poppy. He kicked three. I think it's his biggest haul for a few years now. And even Ben Stratton got on the goal sheet picks.
Yeah, they just looked happy, didn't they? They looked so happy for their teammates. They're a great footy club. Their coach is a star, we know that.
It was classily held, wasn't it?
When it's Happy Clarko on the boundary line, he's infectious. He's like that in life. Vella's just smiling, you're smiling, because he's got a bit of cheek about him, and his players have always played for him, and they did yesterday, and I thought they played for each other, and they certainly played for the leaders. They played for Poppy, they played for Stratton. You can just see the joy in Isaac Smith's face, sitting on the interchange bench, who's injured at the moment, and the coach, and his team as well. So I thought it was a fantastic way to send them off and a great way to finish the year.
Not so much for the Gold Coast Suns, though, was it? A really disappointing way for their campaign to end. And as you're about to see, Pix, it's continued something of a trend at this club.
Yep.
Have a look at the starts they've made in the last five seasons. 65% win rate. They burst out of the blocks.
They do, and that's fantastic to get away to a good start. But what do you do next after that?
Well, yeah. You thought the sun sets early when daylight savings ends. Yeah. Have a look at this after round five.
Yeah, this has been a worrying trend, as they say. It's been 5 years now of 13% wins after round four. I mean, that's horrible.
And like, I mean, you're
going to finish in the bottom couple if that's what's going to be dished up as the season goes on. Now, it's a different team this year. We know that. But in saying that, this young team are going to have to grow and go really quickly. Really quickly, because at the moment, they're just wasting seasons.
The green shooters, Brendan Bolton would say, is clearly the percentage there at the top right-hand corner of your screen. 2020, they finished the season with a 90.6 percentage, which is a lot better than what recent history is.
Well, what it does tell you is that they've been a lot closer and competitive in games. So in the past, we've seen the Gold Coast get hammered by 10, 15 goals. Those losses this year have been reduced to a margin that is, you know, sometimes in the 3-2, 3-4 goal margins, which will get your percentage around that sort of 90 to 100%, which if you're around that mark, I mean, that's as good as some of the teams that are just outside the eight.
Yeah.
So they just need to make sure they've got to find a way to win as the season goes on.
GWS have had a hugely disappointing year from grand finalist to non-finals participant. Is it about to get worse, Pix? Because GWS, they've got a giant off-season ahead of them. Let's have a look at this. We know that Aiden Corr will almost certainly join North Melbourne now. That's pretty much done. And now Zach Williams will nominate, probably as early as tomorrow, that Carlton is his club of choice, the free agent. And then you got question marks on another five.
Okay, well, Cameron's the big one out of that other crew. The rest of them are young fellas, really. Cameron, well, desperately, I heard Sam Jacobs talking on radio today. He thinks that Cameron will stay. Jai Corr will Jai Caldwell's been... He's actually been linked to St Kilda.
He has.
And then you look at some of these other ones and...
Pateley at Adelaide.
Yeah, O'Halloran's another one. And Perryman, who's sort of in and out of the side a little bit, isn't he, really?
Yeah.
So...
You've got to pay the Perryman, though. But what about Zach Williams? So, 26 yesterday he was. He used his birthday to tell Leon Cameron, sorry, boss, I'm out. I know you've been on record as saying you've got a gut feel that I'll stay for another 4 or 5 years, but I won't be. And then he went over and did a medical at Carlton, and he'll nominate them soon. And that's a big get for the Blues.
Oh, it's exactly what the Blues need. They need him in the inside midfield. That's what he is.
Yep.
And he gives them run and spread, which they don't really have at the moment. They've got some nice inside mids, some tough inside mids, but... none of them really spread. Walsh spreads a bit, but certainly Cripps doesn't spread. If they can get in Williams to do that, they're also being linked to Adam Sard, I believe, the Blues. So they might get pretty active in this trade period.
Yeah, and the offer not quite as good as North Melbourne's, but they said to Zach Williams, basically, look, if money is your sole deciding factor here, we're probably not the club for you. But if you've got other reasons, then we're happy to have you. And he's chosen the Blues ultimately in the end, which is a big win for
them.
Which
is good. And North Melbourne have got Aiden Corr, which, it's good to get one locked away early when you've delisted 11. To be able to at least throw one straight back in the mix. So hopefully North are out there doing the same thing.
After this, Harley Bennell. It was the fairy tale story of 2020. It's ended in something of a nightmare. Does he play on next year at Melbourne? Welcome back to the Oval Office, where the top eight is set. Can't wait for finals action in 2020, but picks plenty happening away from the field as well. Before we get to that, Monopoly at Macca's is in full swing, by the way. Full terms and conditions at mcdonalds.com.au. The fairy tale story that was Harley Bennell was in full swing at the start of the year. Yep. He was loved. He was given the third chance, ultimately, by the Melbourne Football Club. Well, he's done what he should have done. He left the hub up there in Queensland and breached protocol, and Melbourne's been fined $50,000. Harley Bennell suspended for 4 matches, and it's thrown his career in serious jeopardy.
Yeah, it has, and it's very sad to see, and it's disappointing for Harley that he's put himself in this position again, because he's had a few misdemeanors in the past. He's a fine young player. We like him. Oh, he's not a young player anymore. I mean, we've probably said that way too much. He's got a lot of talent. He was getting his footy career back on track. He's had so many soft tissue injuries in that calf. And then just to let himself down, which he has had a tendency to do in the past, it's so disappointing. It's not like the club don't need to be carrying 50 grand into their soft cap, that's for sure, let alone paying the fine, firstly. And now he's not even going to be available for 4 matches, so... what they do with him at the end of the year now, it's really up for grabs.
Yeah, I think that career is just about over, sadly, and he was a real chance to get another contract, I'm told. But Friday, the team went on the bus to get down to the Gold Coast to play the football and against Essendon, and Harley got on the drink, made some poor decisions and left the hub to go down to the Gold Coast to visit a friend down there. So less than ideal for Harley Bennell, the worst possible time as well. What about the Blues? It's been the bugbear for them all year. Massive momentum swings against. It was another 5-goal swing at the weekend against the Brisbane Lions. And as you're about to see, David Teague, normally mild-mannered, quietly spoken, he finally lost it.
Keep your eye on David Teague. He has gone right through the
media. Yeah, there you go. Have a look at Teague. We can't... They've muted it.
Just in time.
Just in time, because he's not all that thrilled with them, David. I've actually never been on the end of one of those sprays as his manager, so that's a good thing. I don't really want to be copping one of them from him. But
we haven't seen that, though, have we?
He's a mildly mild-mannered sort of guy, but he has got a nasty streak in him, and that's what every coach has got. And you know what? It was about time, as in about time that team heard that, because their second quarter was insipid, in my view, and it's cost them the match. So I understand why the coach was upset with that, and fitness, fair enough too, in my view.
Must be enormously frustrating, because yet again they fight out the game. The final score looks respectable on paper, but yeah, you look at that swing where they go to sleep for half an hour and the game's over.
Well, it kills them, and it's killed them all year, and it's the reason they're not playing finals is because they've had lapses, and that's something that he'll need to get out of that group, and that group will have to be mature enough to get out of it. They're not a young team, so there should be enough leadership on the ground to arrest a two-goal run on, let alone when they're kicking fours and fives in a row. So I thought it was good to see, because I know that he's got that in him. But, you know what? He got a response, because the third quarter and the last quarter, they were a hell of a lot better.
When we come back after the break, we'll have a look, picks. We'll cast our eye over the bottom 10 teams and what it means for them going into the off-season and pre-season, and some big questions that need to be answered. Welcome back to the Oval Office. All thanks to Monopoly at Macca's, which is in full swing, of course. All right, Liam Pickering, we're going to turn to finals next week. But for now, so many questions pertaining to the sides who didn't make it, the 10 clubs who won't play finals and the burning that they face. This is them here.
Yep.
My question for you, who's the big out of that group there below us, who's the biggest disappointment in 2020?
Oh, clearly the GWS Giants. I mean, the Giants have been horrible. With that amount of talent that they've got on that list, they haven't played as a team. They've played pretty individually, I think. They've been a massive disappointment, as have the Bombers, and as have...
I think North Melbourne you can argue for, and Adelaide.
Adelaide and Hawthorn, for that matter.
Yep.
I don't think we expected that much from Adelaide. We certainly didn't expect them to be last. The Suns were the Suns. Well, they've probably gone up a couple of spots. Fremantle, I think, have got a real improver. The Blues, I think, was about where they were going to get to, and probably Melbourne a little bit as well. But look, if you're looking at nail it on one, it's the Giants.
While they're all disappointed not to feature in October, as it now is, who feels best about themselves going into the off-season?
Well, I like the Swans, personally.
That
effort. We can like it together.
We'll
all be happy and friendly. Okay. I like the Swans because, one, I think they've got a great bunch of kids. They seem to play for each other. They seem to play for the coach. That's firstly. Secondly, they'll get back Buddy next year. They'll get back
Heaney.
And also they'll get back Papley, who missed the last few games. Rampy, not Papley. Papley should have kicked about six goals yesterday. He kicked a lot of points. So I think the Swans, with the young talent that they've got coming through.
All right, then. Which team will make the finals next year, Pix?
Out of that crew? I think Melbourne will make the finals next year.
Based on what?
I just think that they've got the talent there. They just don't play like it. You know, and they've finished the year okay. Their last couple of wins were pretty good.
They'll certainly be under pressure to make it, as will the Blues.
Yeah.
As will the Giants.
I think the Blues will improve too next year. So I think the Blues... You'd say the Giants are the obvious one to say, oh, they should make the 8. Well, of course they should make the 8, but depends who's still there.
Yeah.
Seems to be everyone seems to be going, so I don't know.
Okay, which club, conversely, is in for a tough 2021?
Well, a tough 2021 out of that crew. Oh, I don't see North getting much better in
You'd
a real
have to
hurry.
Say North are about to bottom out big time here. Massive list turnover.
And there'll be a big watch. Oh, there will be, yeah. And well, they've already got rid of 11 players. I mean, they haven't even got warm yet. I mean, that axe is still warm. They're still going to lop a few more off, I believe. So Hawthorn will be interesting to watch what they do over the pre-season, because they're not just going to... They're going to go to the draft, no question. But they're going to also look to trade and bring players in. So they don't live in that part of the ladder, Hawthorn. So I expect them to improve next year.
It's a pressure-based game, of course, and you live and die by your results. So of the coaches of those clubs, which coach is under the most pressure going into next year?
Well, Leon, obviously. I feel for Leon, but his team was in a grand final last year. Where were they this year? Out of the 8. Yeah. Staggering to believe with that amount of talent. So, obviously, Leon's under a lot of pressure. Of the others, you know, Reece Shaw's only had a year, so you've got to give him a go. Matty Nix has had a year, give him a go. Stewie Jew seems to be building something. Clarko, he'll be fine. Johnny Longmire's fine. Longmuir's had a great year at Fremantle, so no real issues with the rest of them.
AFL's trying to put some changes around what the payouts might look like for these coaches as well. I don't know if contracts mean anything anymore, but Simon Goodwin's contracted until 2022 and Leon Cameron until 2023, obviously freshly re-signed as well.
Yeah, but that's okay. I mean, you can still work through it. If the teams aren't performing, we know who cops it in the neck, and it's normally the coach.
Who do you find the most intriguing out of that group next year? Who shapes as the most fascinating club?
The Blues for me.
Yep.
Just purely because they've been linked already to two players that will help them straight away. If they get Adam Saad and they bring in Zach Williams, I mean, they'll improve straight away. And I don't think they're that far off. That's my personal view. But I think they'll be an intriguing team next year, the Blues. They played games this year where you went, wow, they're a finals type team.
Yeah.
But then they had some horrible performances as well. So I think overall, they fascinate me, the Blues, what they do in the off-season.
And they'll get Charlie Curnow back as well. For mine, it's all about the Hawks. You know, the coach that doesn't believe in the draft, but they need to rejuvenate and rebuild at the same time. Are they still a destination club?
Oh, I think they are. I think yesterday showed that... You know, anyone that watched that game yesterday would say, if you're a player there, that looks like a good club to go.
But they've had some horrible games at the same time.
Yeah, they have. They haven't had a great year. They started off with two wins to start the year. And the minute this COVID hit, The wheels fell completely off Hawthorn, and they only really got them going in a couple of games.
I don't think they've been happy in the hub either. The hub has agreed with some teams and not others, and they have been pretty open, I think, in it hasn't worked for them.
I think it's obvious it hasn't worked for Hawthorn. It's obvious it hasn't worked for Essendon. Mm. And I would probably go as far as to say North Melbourne is in a similar situation.
And a lot of questions to be answered on, albeit they're contracted. Luke Bruce, Jack Gunston and Isaac Smith's a free agent as well. What they do with those players over the off-season will be interesting as well. We'll take a break here on the Oval Office. Back to wrap up right after this. Yes, it's been great to have your company here on the Oval Office. Monopoly at Macca's is in full swing, full terms at mcdonalds.com.au. And as is the case each and every week, picks, we couldn't do it without this bad boy, the Dometic CI42 Icebox. You keep things cool with Dometic Mobile Living Made Easy. Someone who's made it very easy, made it look very easy this year is Lachie Neale. It's the award season's coming up. Is he a set and forget Brownlow medalist?
Well, I think he is, yeah. It's a bit like when Tom Mitchell won. I mean, he looks the clear winner to me, but the only danger I see is Travis Boak, and he'll vote really well, Travis Boak. He's had a fabulous season. Maybe Petraka for third for me.
Is anyone else? Boak?
Who did you think I said? Who did you think I said
Steel?
Second?
Steel? Danger?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. Okay. No, I think it's really Neale and Boak to fight it out. That's my view.
What about Lachie Neale outmarking Levi Casbolt in the back 50?
Come on, Levi.
That was unbelievable.
Got to be better than that, Levi.
What about the rising star? We would have probably thought that Matty Rowe would have it locked away by round 10. Clearly, he was sadly lost a long time before that. Is it Caleb Sarong's to lose?
Well, not his to lose. I think Nara Anderson's got a really good chance. In fact, I'd be saying it's a line ball between those two.
Yep.
And if I have to go out on a limb, I'll say Noah Anderson. I think he's been underrated for a first-year player. I think he's been fabulous.
And played each and every game as well and been pretty consistent right across
and the And Sarong's been great. Don't get me wrong. I'm not having to go at Caleb Sarong. He's had a fabulous year too. But I do like Noah Anderson. I do think he might win it.
Just quickly, we've got time. Trade season coming up, going to be huge. Ben Brown, we haven't discussed tonight.
Ooh.
Where do you think? What do you think?
Well, if North, he doesn't stay at North, I'll tell you what, he'd be going after him if it was me.
Who?
I'd be going after him at Melbourne.
Right.
100 mile an hour.
It'd fit in well there.
Yeah, fit in perfectly there.
There you go. I like that. Liam Pickering, Ben Brown to Melbourne is the headline. Thanks for your time tonight on the Oval Office. Finals next week. We can't wait. Look after yourselves.